Hello and welcome back to Fast Charge. I'm your host Dom and I'm joined this week by the usual suspects, Toddy and Lewis.
Hello.
And the slightly more unusual suspect, Aniron, is joining us as well this time around.
Hello.
So we have a busy week, slightly sad one. Since we last spoke to you all, LG confirmed the long suspected news that it was leaving the mobile phone industry. So we will have our little sort of in memoriam section at the end as we break out our violins to commemorate LG. We're going to talk about kind of what this means for the industry looking forward with LG ducking out, but also LG's history, some of its biggest innovations. There's a lot of kind of smartphone staples now that LG did first, which I think are worth running through and why they mattered in their time in the industry. But before that, we actually have some new phones to talk about. We have loads of new phones that all came today. First up, Lenovo launched the Legion Phone Duel 2, aka the Legion Phone Pro 2, if you're in China, which is their new big silly gaming phone. It's even bigger and sillier than last year's one. It looks pretty mad. So Anara is going to run us through that before Lewis does his best to explain all six phones that Nokia dropped in one go during an event just half an hour ago. They have completely upended their phone lineup. They've changed their naming and their branding of the handsets. They've got a whole new system, six phones to go along with it, plus headphones, and at least in the UK, their own new mobile network. So it's been a big day for Nokia, and there's a lot to talk about there. First up, though, other little bits and pieces from the week that's gone. First up, today saw OnePlus announce a new phone, kind of. It dropped on its social media the OnePlus Nord LE, which stands for the literally only one edition. This is just a glorified competition, but it is kind of a fun one. They've created a new version of the Nord with a kind of green-orange gradient finish. So it's a different color of the existing OnePlus Nord, basically. But they say they are literally making one of them. And there's a competition on their Instagram account for someone to win it and win the single OnePlus Nord LE. It's a publicity stunt, but I quite like that as a fun way to do a competition for a phone. That's kind of cool. There's kudos there to having like the only one of its kind device.
Well, so there aren't enough orange phones nowadays, not since like the fluorescent Nokia 930, Lumia 930.
You get the big orange leather ones occasionally. Oh, yeah. The Oppo. The
Find X2 Pro.
Yeah, and the Vivo X60 Pro Plus in China has an orange one, but they maybe smartly decided the rest of the world wouldn't buy the orange leather. I don't know. But that's kind of cool. Speaking of Oppo and Vivo, wow, that worked perfectly. There was a lot of foldable leaks this week, but one of the interesting ones was through kind of display manufacturer channels, essentially. But word has come out that Oppo is working on not one, but two foldables to come out this year, both inward folding. It seems like everyone's coalesced around the inward fold form factor now. But Oppo is working on two of them in different sizes. I think they're still both meant to be large Galaxy Fold style foldables rather than small flip slash razor style foldables. But we'll wait and see. And Vivo is also working on one foldable. Again, also inward folding, expected to be around the size of the Galaxy Fold or the, you know, the Xiaomi Mi Mix Fold or the Huawei Mate X, etc., etc. Google, word has come out this week, this is actually very interesting, that the Pixel 6 might not run a Qualcomm Snapdragon chipset, which is really weird. So the Pixel 5 made news last year when they went with the 765G chipset rather than the 865. So they decided not to use a flagship chip in their flagship phone. Apparently this year they're just dropping Qualcomm altogether, and this the Pixel 6 may see the introduction of Google's own custom silicon made together with Samsung. So apparently you'll have some of the DNA of the Exynos chips, which, you know, depending on your outlook, may not seem like a very good thing, but we'll see what we actually get at the end of it all. All we know is that the chip is codenamed Whitechapel. I'm not sure why. That's like a kind of rundown district in East London, most famous for Jack the Ripper. A lot of good kebabs there at the moment. I like Whitechapel. I don't really know how it made its way into the name of Google's first custom phone chip. But yeah, we'll see. If that is true, that is quite a big shakeup for the industry and yet another kind of loosening of Qualcomm's previously pretty iron grip on the chipset industry, but it's definitely shaken at the moment. Google had a worse time this week on the headphones front when it managed to leak its own product. It's been kind of expected for a while that we're getting another generation of Pixel Buds. They're probably going to turn up alongside the Pixel 5a. We think they're going to be called the Pixel Buds A. I think maybe a sort of slightly cheaper run on them. And then Google sent out a newsletter a few days ago with images of a few of its products, including images of a pair of Pixel Buds that come in a color that you cannot buy Pixel Buds right now, with a colored case that you cannot buy Pixel Buds in right now, and with a slightly different finish that, guess what, you cannot buy Pixel Buds in right now. It looks, to all intents and purposes, like someone internally grabbed the wrong Google Pixel Buds image and threw an unreleased product into their mailer on, you know, the latest stuff in the Google store. So really daft. And then finally, not a leak, actually intentionally teased. We spoke last week that Sony's announced an Xperia event for next week, and they've actually put out a couple of teaser videos that confirm quite a lot of the leaks we've seen so far. Basically, sort of, you know, little slow-mo glimpses of the phones, but it suggests that once again we're not seeing a radical design shift. These are going to look we're expecting the Xperia 1, 3, and 10 3. They're going to look a lot like last year's phones. It looks like we're getting a triple camera module, which again was no great surprise. Eagle-eyed people have spotted that it does look like one of those is a periscope lens, which again has been kind of rumored and teased a fair bit. But yeah, all those kind of stars seem to be lining up. We are finding out next week on the 14th. I want to say Wednesday. Yeah, that is Wednesday. So on the show next week, we'll be able to actually talk about those new Sony phones and see what they are. But I'm excited for more Sonys. Right, so onto phones that actually exist and we actually can talk about. The Lenovo Legion Phone Duel 2, which is such a messy name. It really bothers me that even on their very first gaming phone, they went Lenovo Legion Phone Duel. And it's just going to get worse from here, especially, you know, inevitably once we start getting like a pro variant next year and things like that. And Nairin, you have all the details on this. So this is Lenovo's big gaming phone. It's their second generation. It looks a lot like the first generation in some respects, which means it's weird. The rear cameras are in the center of the phone. There's a side-mounted pop-up selfie camera. It's basically all geared around holding it horizontally, right?
Yeah, so that's what I mean. So obviously they're very much pitching it at gamers, so they want... they're thinking most gamers, it's very, very few kind of high-end, these kind of graphic-intensive titles are going to be played in portrait. So they've kind of geared the phone all around landscape, horizontal usage. So like you say, the big thing there is the pop-up selfie camera, which is 44 megapixel Samsung sensor. And it's got like an 8. Yeah, so they're really kind of prioritizing, because what they're, how they pitched it in the briefing was kind of that it's going to be used for people who want to like stream directly from their phone. They're going to stream on Twitch or whatever. So they're going to want that a high quality sensor. Obviously we know that megapixel count doesn't always guarantee that.
No.
Yeah, so it's got like an 84, it's like a wide angle lens, an 84 degree field of view. Yeah. Yeah, so it looks interesting. And I kind of like, obviously we've seen a few pop-up selfie cameras come like out of the top of the phone to like create this bezel-less design, but I kind of quite like this, that it's kind of focusing on being able to get more in the shot and just kind of hopefully look as the quality of self and kind of being able to stream at, I think that camera is capable of streaming at 4K, so to be able to do that in a selfie camera is relatively rare.
I think one of the saddest little things we've seen in the phone industry over the last year or so, and I know a lot of people disagree with me on this, but I lament the fact that pop-up cameras came and went, and I wish they'd stuck around, because actually some of my favorite phones have been the ones where you get the actual full screen experience and then a selfie camera that pops up. It means they can make the selfie cameras bigger and better because they're not trying to fit around the punch hole, which has been one of the things that limits selfie like quality over the last few years. You get bigger, better screens. And I don't use my selfie camera a lot, so pop-ups make sense. And then this is absolutely not for me. I don't game a lot on my phone, so I'm not using it landscape very often. So this would make zero sense for me. But I think it's so smart for people who do game a lot. I can totally see the appeal of this, and I'm honestly surprised we haven't seen anyone ape it in the past year. And I still expect we will see people copy it going forwards.
Because I think the idea that Lenovo is having here is that they're going to put all the components, like all the CPU and GPU and anything that could, all the main components in the middle of the phone. Mm. And then, so then they've got the dual name is kind of referring to the two batteries. So they've got, they're both 2,750 milliamp hours, which is 5,500 in total across the two. And then there's separate USB-C charging ports for both of them. So the idea is that the same as last year. So the idea is that you plug them both in at the same time. And that will get you to 90 watts fast charging, which they say will do a full charge in half an hour, which is great. But obviously they don't include, they're not going to include that 90 watt adapter in the box. But yeah, that sounds quite promising. And I understand. And I think they were claiming that the battery will get you 8 hours of intermittent gaming on a single charge, but
whatever that means. Presumably battery life is not going to be helped by the decision to throw in two fans this time.
So they've added a separate fan, and they've got kind of this like really aggressive vapor cooling system, so they're like desperate for it never to overheat. And that's kind of part of the idea of the two batteries, because obviously a lot, if you have like having the two batteries would mean that where you're holding your hands, neither it'll never be hot to the touch. I think that's the idea.
That's the pitch. I mean, I never actually got to try the first Legion, so I don't know how well it pulled off the trick.
Neither do I, but I kind of because I've tested phones like some of the Red Magic phones who've had a built-in fan, and it's been pretty effective. The one thing that I was impressed by was that a lot of the fans can start running really loudly and kind of distracting from the gaming experience, but they've said it's going to be at its maximum of 27 decibels, which sounds kind of promising because they're trying to create this whole immersive gaming experience. So the display is one of the biggest area that's been upgraded. So that's now a 6.92 inch AMOLED.
It's worth dwelling on. That is huge.
Massive. So it was 6.6 last year.
Yeah. So that's bigger than the Ultras, right? If I'm not mistaken, that's bigger than the S21 Ultra and certainly bigger than the Xiaomi Ultra.
Mm-hmm.
This will be one of the biggest phones around now.
Yeah. So it's still 144 hertz. Still at full HD, kind of to balance that battery life thing,
which makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah. The original, obviously the Red Magic 6 comes out, which has bumped that up to 165 hertz. So it's not got that kind of class leading refresh rate, but
yeah,
I mean, I've been testing the Red Magic and it's very kind of marginal gains. It's so hard to tell the difference.
We've had this conversation before. I mean, most phone games aren't taking advantage of 120 hertz yet, let alone 140, mm-hmm. let alone 165. So, you know, it's a great thing to say on the tick on the phone box that you've got the highest refresh rate or whatever. Mm. But I think in day-to-day use, it's not going to matter for most people, is it? 144 is already overkill. So it's the same as like the question of like, you know, oh, well, the ROG Phone 5 has 18 gigs of RAM and this one only goes up to 16. You know, it's like, well, 16 is already more RAM than you need. Like, you're not going to notice any difference between the 16 here and the 18 in the competitor.
I don't know whether I can say it's... I think I prefer the design over last year's model. I don't know whether it's more tasteful, but it's, I think, better because they've gone sort of more utilitarian. Like, it looks... Obviously, I haven't held it, but... With the fan module in the middle with the cameras and stuff. They still have the RGB, but it looks a little bit less crazy. Mm. They have these like funny like glass pattern effects on last year's model, which doesn't appear to be there this year. And instead, it almost looks like they're two grips for your palms, like those two kind of just segments, I presume, where the batteries also live.
Yeah, that's right.
So I think I prefer the design of this one, both aesthetically and the fact that they've just made it more utilitarian, but still kept the RGB and stuff like that.
I agree. I do want to ask on the design. I mean, I think I know the answer, but on the back, it looks kind of like the bit in the middle is a display like we saw in the ROG Phone 5.
Yeah,
but it's not right. It's just an RGB lighting section.
Yeah, that's it. That was just an RGB lighting. They didn't actually, I think it was one of the questions at the end of the briefing that someone asked, is there actually RGB lighting? Because they didn't kind of draw attention to it, I guess, because there are other phones that have got this kind of mini display. But yeah, so obviously they've put a lot of emphasis on the front cameras. There's two rear cameras as part of that kind of central module. I think it's a 64 megapixel main sensor, and then a 16 ultra wide. Mm-hmm. Cameras are never kind of a real priority in gaming phones, but something that's able to take a decent shot. What I will say is that does create a huge camera bump. So it's really kind of, it's one of the most noticeable things. But if you lay it down on the table, it's absolutely huge.
Really?
We need to side by side with the Mi 11 Ultra.
That's what I mean. I've seen some comparisons to that. Yeah. It's like,
I mean, the phone as a whole looks just enormous.
Beastly, yeah.
Just, again, you know, as we said, it's a huge display. But, you know, it looks thick, it looks heavy. Did they give you any actual, like, dimensions on it, or have they kept that to themselves for now?
I think they did. They gave a detailed, I don't have the figure to hand, but they did give a really, they had, like, a very detailed spec sheet.
Yeah, right.
And included that.
I've got here, I've got 9.9 millimeters thick, so it's near enough a centimeter thick.
Wow.
Which is pretty heavy duty.
I don't know when the last time was we saw a phone that actually was, like, at the centimeter mark.
The only one I can think of is that ridiculous Duracell phone that never saw the light of day.
Sure, yeah. that the ones like that are just battery. Power banks with a phone strapped to the side of it.
Yeah.
I guess with all this stuff, it depends where you measure it as well, because I suspect the Mi 11 Ultra would be a centimeter at the camera module.
Mm-hmm.
Just that's not where they measure it, because that one's 8-9 millimeters, you know, for the body, but there's, you know, at least another 2 millimeters from the camera module, so that will break the centimeter mark there. But
one thing I was thinking about is that on the software side, how well optimized it will be kind of for this horizontal game, because obviously a lot of phones are designed to be used in portrait. So it comes with like Lenovo's own like skin over Android. I think it's ZUI. But in a lot of the screenshots and a lot of the kind of detail about it, it seems still very kind of typical portrait mode. So I will be interested to see if it feels like it's genuinely been designed with
to use in portrait all the time. Phone. Yeah.
Yeah. Or whether, you know, because it often feels like using in landscape mode is a bit of an afterthought on a lot of phones. It doesn't really feel like it's well suited for it.
No, totally. Android doesn't in general play with landscape especially well. It never has really. But I can't imagine that will really change here. And I to be fair, I don't think many users would stick with landscape when they're not gaming. I guess the awkwardness is that question of, even if you're a gamer and you stream and you buy this so that you can stream yourself while you're playing, you still will other times just want to have a video chat with your friends. And at that point, you've got to hold the phone in horizontally to have that video call with your friends and your family or whatever. And if you're trying to at that point, you're just like committed to that. You're committed to doing any multitasking, also still in landscape mode and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah,
and
it would be true.
At that point, it's like, does that get annoying or does that work pretty well?
In terms of that high-res front camera as well, I wonder whether it's like it just inherently supports 4K resolution where you know the recipient device can show 4K content, or whether it's like app optimized, so they'd have to like talk to developers to make sure it's implemented in the right way. Like if you can stream on Twitch with a front camera using that phone, what resolution is that being like brought down to? Be interesting to know some of that finer details if they're really going for this market as aggressively as they are.
Yeah, because I do remember with the first one, there was talk about sort of compatibility with apps and services being built up. And again, we never saw the first one, so I'm not sure how well they pulled that off and how much better they're doing now. It is telling, I think, that they do go for a global launch. And I'm kind of impressed and surprised by that, because Lenovo is a Chinese company and they pretty much gave up on all their other phones globally. And I think no one would have been too shocked if the Legion phones had just been China-only handsets. I think it is telling that they are pushing them worldwide, and they released it worldwide last year and they're releasing it worldwide this year. And if you're going to do that, you've got to be pushing, you know, you can't just be pushing in the Chinese gaming ecosystem to make those deals and those partnerships, right?
Yeah.
I'm surprised you got a sequel there, nonetheless.
I'm a little surprised, but I guess, I mean, we'll talk about people leaving the phone industry before, but Lenovo was probably at a point where it, you know, kind of just had to decide whether to stop doing phones, or at least in terms of its global position, whether to bother putting them out or whether to double down and keep going and push ahead. And I suppose once you put all the R&D into building this weird one-of-a-kind phone,
yeah,
you know, you might as well do another one. And they did, you know, get a lot of kudos last year. I think people liked the first one a lot.
Yeah, I will just say, like, because we've seen so many, we've seen, like, just in the last month, we've seen, like, the Rog Phone 5, the Red Magic, the Black Shark. So there is kind of a big gaming, even though maybe it's kind of targeted towards Chinese customers, there is still kind of a big market there. Just on pricing, where this fits in. So it starts at, we have 699 for 12 gigs of RAM and 256 storage, and then it goes up to 899 for the 16512. So that's kind of pitched slightly below the Rog Phone 5, but kind of in that area of kind of premium high-end gaming space.
It's definitely pricier than the Red Magics or...
Yes,
or,
absolutely. Oh, yeah. I mean, we don't have...
It's slower than I was expecting.
That's what I mean. I thought they definitely had the potential with the kind of high-end specs that we're talking, they had the potential to push it kind of closer to kind of proper true flagship territory. But obviously it really still, even though there aren't a huge amount of changes, it really does stand out instantly, doesn't really look like anything else on the market. There's kind of a lot of unique selling points, even if a few of them might be a little gimmicky or not appeal, have mass appeal.
I think it's one of those things where I'm curious if they have the guts and the budget to stick it out, because I think these are like just a bit ahead of their time, and that pitch of stream from your phone while gaming on your phone and a camera setup built for that is fantastic, and it totally makes sense, and that's absolutely going to be what happens more and more, but it's not what we're at just yet, and the infrastructure around it just isn't there quite yet as far as I'm aware, and it's not easy to do. And I feel like there will be a point where more and more streamers are playing mobile games and want to stream from the same device and be able to do that on the go with one complete setup in their phone and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But it just feels like it's a vanishingly niche prospect right now. And they just need people like Twitch to be throwing money at it as well for it to take off.
I'm going to throw out a prediction that the zenith of the gaming phone concept won't fully be realized till cloud gaming is like commonplace, because you don't need to worry about having necessarily the top end processor, so long as you still have the high refresh rate, high response rate display and the good cameras. Then you can make the phones cheaper, you sell them with a subscription to Stadia or whatever, GeForce Now, whatever, when those are and obviously they have to have 5G. But that's when I think gaming phones will actually become a category that a lot more people actually consider.
And then the challenge there for this model is you then are doubling up your bandwidth constraints, because if the pitch is you're streaming as well, you're trying to stream the game while also streaming your own video feed out, and suddenly it's like, even with 5G, you know, that's puts this extra strain on things. That so it both helps and hurts Lenovo's Legion pitch, I guess.
Roll on 6G, I suppose. That in the next section, yeah, there's a point I'll come to.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. So it's coming to Europe and the UK in May sometime. Is that right? So it's still a few weeks off. But yeah, this looks interesting. And we will see the ROG phone launch officially between now and then. I know it's launched, but it goes on sale again in a couple of weeks. And I'm curious to see how these two actually stack up head to head. Moving on. Let's turn to all things Nokia, of which there are so many things Nokia.
So many things.
I wonder why
there are so many things, but okay.
Yeah, so Nokia held an event today, and I mean, to be fair, we hadn't heard a lot from Nokia in a while, and I had wondered why we hadn't seen any announcements, and there was nothing around February when they would normally do a slate of MWC phones and stuff like that. And I did wonder why the radio silence, and I guess we have our answer, which is that they wanted to have a whole suite of phones ready to go all at once with a new naming convention that they could roll out together. So for the unfamiliar, over the last few years, Nokia, as run by HMD, has pushed out phones with sort of naming and decimal point numbers. So, you know, you got the Nokia 2, then the Nokia 2.1 was the refreshed version of that. And then it was the Nokia 2.2, the Nokia 2.3. And then, you know, if the tier above that was the Nokia 3, which got followed up by the 3.1 and so on. And they went up to 9. They didn't actually hit every number along the way. And different gens, they skipped some decimal points and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But that was the model. Now it's being replaced with a letter and number system, which I think Lewis prefers. I actually like Nokia's naming convention, and I think that I might be an oddity in that. So I'm a little more skeptical about this. But now it's letter ranges. So if I've got this the right way around, the cheapest phones will be C.
Yep.
The next tier up is G.
Yep.
And the next tier up is X.
Got it.
And then it's like C10, C20. Mm-hmm. G10, G20, X10, X20. And that's everything they've announced so far.
It's like a melding of the revamped Motorola Moto G branding and Samsung's A-series.
I assume they're going to follow Samsung's lead. And so then next year, we'll get the X21, which will be the follow-up to the X20.
I'm calling it now.
They've also got other things
whatever you want it to be.
Yeah, the plan is that they've got other ones for each range in the pipeline, and they're going to go up in increments of 10. So I feel like you'll be right there. So next year will be the 21 and then the 22 for that specific model.
And then, I mean, who knows if they'll do more ranges as well, because, I mean, we'll get to this, but right now X is the top tier, but the most expensive phone in that right now is £320 in the UK, which is still pretty, you know, budget mid-range kind of space.
Yeah.
Maybe that means they've recognized that they just can't win in the flagship space and they're going to be sticking to this territory, or maybe they're saving space for the Y series or the Z series or whatever that's going to roll up and be around the sort of 500, 600 mark. I don't think Nokia is going to put any like phones that cost a grand out for a long time.
No way.
You know, that's not their business model right now, on fair play. But
Lewis, do you have any insight, just seeing Alex's question in the comments, on why they picked those specific letters? Do we have any idea as to why they went for those?
They did not say anything about that whatsoever. They were just really proud that they'd actually rebranded themselves.
G, because that's what Motorola uses. And so it immediately puts the customer's mind in the same sort of space.
Yeah.
C for cheap.
Yeah.
X for extreme.
Exactly. X is cool. It's the cool letter. Everyone knows that. And those are their cool phones. Until, again, they release the range up and those are even cooler and they have to figure out why. Like, you know, those are like the Z or the Y.
They have said that these free ranges are their focus for now, because there was questions about a pure view follow-up in the briefing. They were like, no, we're focusing on these. Everyone's hanging on to the pure view.
Let's note as well that they still haven't... they're still screwed by that James Bond partnership they did, where they have prominently had several phones in No Time to Die, and that film still hasn't come out. And
the 8.35G is the Bond phone.
Now they've completely like rebranded the whole structure. They're not even doing a replacement. I mean, who knows what they're going to do with that? So I guess I've already given the like the real Cliff Notes summary. But Lewis, maybe we could run through these ranges in turn, and I guess kind of what price points they're hitting for each, and how competitive they seem for those price points, I suppose, is the way of looking at it.
All right, so let's start at the beginning. And I think that this is actually where it's most interesting, because these start at €75. In the UK, that's £79.99, because we're only getting the C20. So there's the C10 and the C20. The C10 is the cheaper one, and then you've got a slightly more premium one, the C20. So yeah, we're getting the 20. The reason we're not getting the C10 is because it's 3G. And nobody really cares about 3G here anymore.
You're kind of fine, Toddy. You love 3G.
Love 3G. I mean, I'm the biggest proponent of 3G in the office. That's true.
So the C20 offers the upgrade to 4G. So that's the one that's coming to the UK market.
Who needs 4G? That's so too fancy for us.
4G. the biggest surprise is that you're getting kind of a 3,000 milliamp hour battery, a 6.5 inch. It's HD plus rather than full HD plus, which you have to point out. But you know, it's sub £100. And you're getting a pretty decent display. You know, it's not going to... You're going to notice the difference if you're coming from something like an iPhone, but these phones are designed for people that haven't had a smartphone before. They're coming from literal feature phones, and this is their first smartphone. It's only got one gig of RAM.
It is worth saying there, these are priced similarly to when Nokia prices some of its feature phones.
Yeah.
Like, this is kind of at the same price as the upper end of the feature phone pricing. They also do really cheap feature phones. But you know those kind of like 3310... You know, the nostalgia trip feature phones they put out, those all cost the same as these C phones, pretty much.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you've got 1 gigabyte of RAM on offer, which is obviously not great. But they run Android 11 Go, which is tailored to kind of phones with basically no RAM. So, I mean, obviously, I haven't actually had a chance to use it because we've been briefed online, so I haven't got a clue how they actually run in real life. I'm not expecting anything amazing, but if it can access WhatsApp, then I'm sure that's kind of the only thing the people that are buying this phone are really going to care about.
And that's basically it. It'll from using those really budget sub 100 Nokia phones before running Android Go and stuff, it's just like it will just about do those things you want it to do.
Yeah.
It will open Google Maps, it will open WhatsApp, it will open Twitter. It will do those things quite slowly. It will aggravate you along the way, but like it will get there. And if that's your budget, and if you know you don't use your phone a lot, or you don't need it to be fast or whatever, then mm-hmm. you know, they get the job done just about.
Yeah, exactly. And that's kind of, yeah, that's the job. I mean, for people wanting anything more fancy, the next stop up is the G range. And even though it's the next one up, they start at 110, so there's not really a lot of difference between mm-hmm. them in terms of price. So you're getting that same 6.5 inch display, HD plus again, as the C range, but you've got a MediaTek G35 with up to 4 gig of RAM available this time. So, you know, more RAM to play with. It's standard Android, and you get 2 years of security updates and stuff like that. So it's all good on the software front. And kind of looking at the images, it's just, you know, it's basically the exact same design as the C range, but with slightly slimmer bezels and a different finish on the back. The key thing about the G range is the battery life, because they're not just calling this a multi-day battery life phone range. They're saying specifically that the G10 and the G20 can last 3 days on a charge. Mm. And they've got a 5,050 milliamp hour battery. I mean, there are phones that have bigger batteries than that, but paired with just a standard HD display, I feel like there's the potential there. Because I did use the 5.4, which also has a HD plus display, and I think it was like a 3,000 milliamp battery, and that got close to 2 days in my use. Yeah. So I feel like they're on the mark with that kind of thing. And then, yeah, it's you've got an upgraded camera offering on the back. You've got a 13 megapixel main, up from the 5 megapixel. I should say there's 5 megapixels on the C range. You've got a 13 megapixel rear on the G range, which, you know, is a slight bump, but I'm not expecting anything too amazing. There's no kind of partnership or anything like that with anyone.
So still, it's going to be pretty limited.
Yeah, it's just point and shoot. I mean, there are more lenses on the back, but one's a depth sensor, so you don't really care. And the other one's a macro, so you don't really care about that either. So there's one camera on the back that you really care about. Yep. And then you've got an 8 megapixel on the front.
If you look at any of the previous generations of, you know, any of Nokia's affordable phones, like, the fundamental issue is that they always feel underpowered.
Yes.
And I know that they are trying to hit a really conservative price point, of course, mm-hmm. but I would much rather that they didn't bother putting a depth sensor in on that second tier. Yeah. Didn't bother, like, even like, no. I'd take a 4,000 milliamp hour battery just so I could have extra RAM or yes. a little bit better chip. But yeah. I think that's just the breaking point beyond anything else in those phones.
You only need one camera lens on the back, because you're not going to use those cameras for anything yeah. other than really yeah. basic. I want to take a shot to show someone where I am. Like, these are fundamentally yeah. not even going to be good enough for like Instagramming for most people.
No.
Like, but it's more just like, if you don't care about that, if you just want to be able to take couple quick holiday snaps, show something funny you just saw and send it to a friend on WhatsApp, like, they'll do that. You only need one lens for that. You do yeah. not need these other ones. Like, they yeah. cannot even take good shots with them, so they are like wasting space.
Yeah. If you do want something slightly more impressive, the G20 does, one of the main differences between the G10 and the G20 is that main camera. So the G20 has an upgraded 48 megapixel and the aperture of 1.79, which isn't too bad for low light.
Yeah,
that might be okay. promising.
Yeah, so that one seems a lot more promising than the G10, but obviously we haven't seen it, so we can't say for sure. And then that's the paired with the same. Oh, sorry, go on.
Oh, sorry, you finished. Yeah,
I'll say that's paired with an ultra wide, but it's only a 5 megapixel ultra wide, if I remember correctly. So not great.
Same kind of problem.
And then the depth sensor and the macro sensor from the other one.
The thing to note on these ones so far, the C and the G, is that they actually don't have a lot of competition, because
yeah.
even when we talk about all the, like, the cheap Chinese, you know, the brands like Realme and Xiaomi that push very aggressively priced cheap handsets out, actually, even they, for Western pricing, don't tend to go to this kind of circa £100 price point
no.
in the phones that they put out in the West. They tend to kind of go as low as 200, a little bit below that. So it is kind of funny. There are some very cheap Motorola's. Actually, some of the Vivo European phones go this cheap. But that's kind of it. There's not a lot in this space. And as Toddy said, you know, these are always going to be seriously underpowered. And I think the line I always take with these is kind of like, if this is your budget, if your budget is £100 and not a penny more, fine, buy one of these and be fine. But if you can just find £50, you'll get a huge boost and it'll always be worth it. And maybe you can't find 50 quid and that's fine. That's how it is for people. But like, if you can, do. But the funny thing is these look kind of underperforming, but no one else is putting anything else out at that price point. So these might be the best phones around at £80, £110, because I don't know what else you would buy at that price other than a two-year-old phone that's dropped in price, you know.
A quick look on Xiaomi's site. The Redmi 9 is currently on sale for £89. So okay. It down from 140, 150. So
that's the space you get. It is, yeah, buy last year's phone. Last year's budget phone for less would be the competition there. And to be fair, maybe that's the better buy.
I think it gets a little bit harder to justify when it gets to the X range, because even though there's a slight jump between the C and the G, the X range starts at 250 quid. So that's basically double the G range.
I've got to say, I read your article, Lewis, and I you know, read all the specs and everything, and my jaw dropped when I hit the price. Because I was like, what?
Yeah, I know.
That much?
Yeah,
for that?
I know, yeah.
For that phone?
So the value gets quickly worse, does it, as it goes up the letters?
I think you're paying for the Zeiss branding. on the X range. So yeah, the X10 and the X20 have Zeiss partnerships, same as some of the old Nokia phones from yesteryear. And just like the phones, the older ones, it doesn't really make a difference. I mean, you've got a few Zeiss branded features. So you've got, when you're doing a portrait mode, you can change the shape of lights in the background, so you can have them as hearts or stars or swirls or something like that. But I mean, me personally, I can never find any lighting situations where that works anyway. It's just me taking a selfie of a blurred background. That's all I want. But each to their own. So let me just hammer in a little bit on these camera specs. So you've got the X10, which is basically the same camera setup as the G20. It's got that 48 megapixel f1.8 snapper, and then you've got the ultra wide, and you've got the macro, and then you've got the depth sensor. But it's just Zeiss branded this time, so you get that software on top. You get the color grading available in the app and stuff like that.
I think that was basically the same question. Did they say anything specific Zeiss brought that makes the difference here, or just
it's stuff? Zeiss. It's the same, because I think they've done it for so many years at this point. They don't really want to go into it too much. And if they did, you'd probably realize that there's not much they do. But anyway, right. So the X10. Has that 48 megapixel, so basically the same offering as the G20. And then you do get other upgrades on offer. So you've got the Snapdragon 480. So we're finally it's still bad compared to the price, compared to what other others offer at the same price. There we go, got there at the end. And it's got 5G, so that's the X is the only one in the Nokia connection that has 5G.
I was about to say, that's the important thing there, is the 480 is the full series Snapdragon that brings 5G to the table. I don't know if this is the first phone that's run it, but it's one of very few.
Oh, nice.
We haven't seen...
480, yeah.
They only announced it a month or two ago, and I can't think of any other phone that's actually using it yet. But I feel like something would have been announced that I just missed. Yeah. But...
Oh, that's good, though. So you've got that on offer. Alongside, you've got a larger 6.67-inch display, and it is full HD plus this time, finally. But just, you know, the entire Nokia ranges are all capped at 60 hertz, and I think that's a bit of a wet blanket at this kind of at this price, at this point, when you can get phones that are literally 100, 150 quid that have at least 90 hertz. Why are you not putting it on a phone that costs 300 quid?
Well, that's what we're getting. It's a £300 device that's 60 hertz. And uses a full series chipset. I just, you know, you can get an 8 series chipset with 120 hertz in the new Poco X3 Pro for 2/3 of the price.
Yeah.
That's mad.
And it will be the same, give or take the same size. Like, you know, the Poco's kind of bulky and it's not that attractive, but the Nokia's not that much smaller.
There is an argument against that, which I will get to once I get to, I just want to outline the X20, then I'm going to get into why the X range is different to kind of the Chinese competition, if you were. So the X10, you've got 5G, you've got the Snapdragon 480 with either 4 or 6 gigabytes of RAM and up to 128 gig of storage. The X20 is basically the same in terms of spec, but you've got an upgraded 64 meg camera on the rear in place of the 48 megapixel. And yeah, again, it's Zeiss optics. So you've got all that fun stuff there. And you can also do, on the X20, you can do a bothy.
Oh, thank goodness.
Yeah. And you can choose, you can shoot from any of the, so before I think you had to have both. So if you wanted to do both on the back, you had to choose. So if you want to do both, you had to choose them both from the same side or something they're explaining in the keynote. I don't know. But basically now you can choose any camera and record from both of them. It's definitely not the first phone that can do this. Like I remember, I think I had the Galaxy S8 or S7 that could do the exact same thing. Well,
even the term bothy was Nokia's invention. I don't know if they were the first to introduce the concept. Yeah, but they were the first to introduce the term a few years ago.
Basically, Nokia was it 8 or 9?
Yeah, seven? So they've been pushing bothies for a while.
Bothies. But, so yeah, they've upgraded it, so it's a little bit better now.
Yeah.
So yeah, the point of this is that like you were saying, the hardware isn't that sexy compared to what you'll get from other manufacturers, and yeah, that's evident just about every area of the phone. But what you will not get from basically anybody else is, so you've got an upgraded, you've got three full Android software updates coming. So you've got 12, 13 and 14 on the
X20. Is this still on the cheap ones as well?
Sorry,
or just the X?
This is just the X range. Yeah. This is just right. The X range. So you've got three full software updates, and you've also got an extended 3-year warranty in most countries. It obviously depends on the country and whatever, but they're kind of pushing this so that basically you're getting that kind of safety in terms of software, because you've got the software updates, and then you've also got the protection from the hardware perspective with the extended warranty. If anything goes wrong in those 3 years, you can send it back, and that's definitely not something you can say about most of the cheap phones, especially when it comes to software updates. I find you get what you're given, and that's kind of it.
Yeah, I think that's very fair. We'll talk about software updates again a bit later with LG, actually, funnily enough. But yeah, we're seeing more and more brands try and lay down the line on what they will and won't offer. But it is always the turning thing, even if, say, you saw that news a few weeks ago that Samsung is going to give 4 years of security updates. Mm-hmm. It's kind of the small print was like on the flagships. And it's very often that it's when you get to the budget devices that they, even the big brands, just do not bother at all. Yeah. You know, we saw OnePlus normally very good about pushing updates for its phone. When it did the N10 and N100, it gave them each one update to Android 11 and said, that's it, we're done. No, we're not touching these phones again. No OS updates again. So Nokia making that commitment on the X ones is good. And I think they said 2 years of updates on the cheaper ones. Is that
right?
For
the G series, yeah.
Yeah. And there is something to that. You're getting, you know, and I'm not sure if you said, but you are getting stock Android as a software experience, which is a big appeal for a lot of people. And this longevity, I guess it depends what you are looking for in buying a budget phone. You know, are you kind of taking the view that this is cheap so I can buy it and I can replace it in a year or two, in which case, boo, don't do that. It's terrible for the environment, but I appreciate that will be the way a lot of people look at this. Or are you in that position where you're like, you know, if your budget's tight, you're like, I just want to be able to buy one phone and have that phone last me for as long as it possibly can, so I don't have to find the money for a phone again anytime soon. And yeah, this will do better.
That's the kind of angle Nokia's taken. They've also ditched the, they followed everyone else and ditched the power brick in the box in most countries as well. But in its place, they're putting in a biodegradable, 100% biodegradable case.
Decent trade.
Yeah, why not?
Charging cables do these phones use?
Yeah, they're USB-C.
USB-C on the X range, micro USB on the cheaper ones.
Fair.
And you've got 18-watt fast charge on the X range, which, not too bad. Same as the iPhones.
To that point about the kind of replaceability of the phones and the longevity of the phones, I think, you know, you were talking about it, Dom, from the consumer's perspective. I think the reason most companies don't typically do this, and we're seeing that shift over 2020 and 2021, that they are kind of all kind of committing to better software support in the long term, but it's just because it is bad for business in terms of they're probably not making enough money on the initial sale of these really budget devices to warrant the cost of keeping the software up to date for 2 or 3 years down the line. And that's why other companies don't do it. So it's commendable from, like, you know, a green perspective for Nokia to do this. But it's, you know, it's such an unsexy thing to talk about, and it's not something that most companies really bother selling.
There is also a caveat, which is you can improve the software over time, but you cannot improve the hardware over time.
No.
And you're going to be, you know, pushing out more complex OS updates as time goes on. And it's like, if these phones are sluggish on day one, that's not going to get better. Yeah, like giving exactly. it an OS update is not going to make it run faster. It's probably going to make it run slower. If you're lucky, it'll stay the same.
Which and comes so, yes, back to my point, they should spend more upfront on the processor and the RAM than adding in a depth camera or whatever.
Exactly. Like 3 years of updates, great, but I mean, will the Snapdragon 480 still be functional in 3 years? Like, I don't know. We obviously haven't tested that, but like these 4 series chips are very, very slow.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, it will, you know, it will get, the user experience will keep degrading over time. That, you know, and this is just, you know, the challenge with budget phones, it's always the way. So I don't want to, you know, drag Nokia too much for it. And I do think it is good to offer the long-term support and that will appeal to a lot of people. Yeah. But again, like Toddy said, you know, you look at this equation of the specs and stuff they put in and you're like, there's still bits like that camera where they've put in stuff that you think, why couldn't you have taken some stuff out there and put that into the chipset or the RAM?
Oh yeah.
So that long-term 3 year promise actually holds more water, because how many people will buy this thinking, great, I can use this for 3 years. You know, this is so brilliant. But a year and a half in, they're tearing their hair out because it's just so slow that they can't, you know, they can't keep using it and they feel that they need to buy another phone.
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely an interesting thing to think about.
Yeah.
Before we move on to the next, to anything else, I should probably point out there also is a new cheap pair of wireless earbuds, true wireless earbuds that Nokia launched at the event. The light, and they cost $29.99 out in June, so not too bad. The weirdest announcement of the event is that the parent company HMD Global, they are announcing, well, they've announced HMD Mobile, which is a phone network launching in the UK at the end of April.
Yeah. Do you know anything about whether this is just a UK thing or is there an equivalent in some other markets?
No, it's UK only at first with plans to roll out internationally over time, depending on how it goes here. So they're piggybacking off another carrier. They haven't got their own carrier network, obviously. Not saying who that is, which is what I'm quite curious about, because especially when it comes to 4G and 5G, the coverage can vary quite greatly depending on your carrier. So I feel like, especially if you're out in the sticks or something like that, you need to know which carrier that is that they're basing it on.
I feel like they
on.
Might have to say that at some point, but maybe they just haven't announced it yet. I think they feel just like if you're selling that, you do have to kind of say, there's only four it could be, but it doesn't matter which of the four it is.
So it'll be 4G only at first, but they are looking into 5G and rolling it out soon, and the contract starts at $650 a month. So the idea is that basically they want Nokia.com to be the one-stop shop for everything Nokia. So you go there, you buy the phone, and you can also now get your SIM card for the phone, and that comes all connected. And then you can also get things like insurance directly from Nokia as well. So they basically want it to be like, well, come when you want a phone, come here.
It's an interesting pitch. It kind of takes the space of, like, you know, in the UK, we have a store called Carphone Warehouse, and, you know, other countries have the same thing, which is where you go and you can get your handset, you can get it on, you know, a contract, you can get the whole thing set up in one go, but you get all this choice. But yeah, having an actual manufacturer wade in and offer the same thing. It's interesting. It's not something I'd really considered before. And I'm kind of surprised, of all companies, it's Nokia doing it first. Though in a way, I suppose it makes sense, because the other side of Nokia is they do a lot of networking stuff. And I don't know how close the links are between the bits of the business. And I know there's distinction between Nokia, the brand run by HMD, and Nokia, Nokia, the networking company. And they are separate companies. And I don't know how HMD fits in entirely from that back-end perspective. But there are at least some links there that I guess maybe they're leveraging.
I remember going to the reps at the Nokia booth at, I think it was NWC. Maybe the first year or second year that HMD had taken over the phone side of things. And I asked for someone who works on the phone booth. They didn't even know that they had a subsection of their booth that was dedicated to phones, feature phones and smartphones. So they were like calling people and they were like, we don't know who you're trying to get hold of. And then I just realized I could just see it over in the corner, kind of tucked away.
Side, the other bit.
So I think it is, or at least was, pretty separate from the rest of the Nokia business when HMD first took over the reins of the phone side of things.
Who knows if that's improved. It's a weird one, but interesting. It does feel like something, you can only imagine other brands are looking at this with interest. I mean, how much would Apple love to be able to sell you its own contract and SIM and everything like that, so that you buy everything through Apple? That would be their dream. Okay, I think that about does it on that. Let's turn to LG for our final segment. So this is news I don't think came to as a surprise to anyone, but LG's done with phones. We've known this for so long, and there've been leaks along the way, and it's been almost confirmed a few times, but this week finally LG itself actually put out a statement and said they are shuttering their phone business after decades of making phones. Actually, at one point they were the third biggest phone manufacturer in the world. They fell to quite a lot less than that. I believe their market share last year was about 2% globally, and they were a long way from the number three spot, so we knew this was coming. The big sadness, I guess, in the immediate future is it means the LG Rollable is presumably dead in the water. We will likely never see that in its finished form. And you can be sure that prototypes are going to start surfacing at some point, and there's going to be huge interest in sort of the only prototypes that make it out of LG headquarters and stuff like that. I'm very curious to see if some other brand maybe manages to license that in some way and push that out, take advantage of the R&D that's been done, but probably not. But anyway, I thought it'd be nice to run through some of what LG did accomplish over its time in the industry, because yes, they were like the number three in the world at one point, but also they, you know, introduced a lot of the stuff that we now take completely for granted in smartphones, and they were a huge innovator in the space that over the last 5 years at least they've not been rewarded for, perhaps, and maybe not gotten the dues that they deserve. But it goes all the way back. I'm going to stick to the smartphone era, but if you go back to 2006, they actually introduced the first full touchscreen capacitive phone.
The LG. Chocolate?
This is the Prada.
Oh, the Prada. Yes, I remember.
I had the Prada. Which was
December 2006.
Eilish.
It beat the iPhone. The iPhone got announced a month later. But it just beat the iPhone to announcement. It was monochrome, so you can see why the iPhone drew a bit more attention when it launched. But it was a monochrome touchscreen device. And I was looking, and actually, apparently, Apple's never released sales figures for the first iPhone, so no one's sure. But the Prada sold quite well, and so there is good reason to believe it actually outsold the first iPhone.
Wow.
Which obviously that fortunes reversed over time.
I'm throwing a picture of it on screen for everybody who's watching the stream to see.
I remember this phone.
Yeah, it's pretty wild. I'd completely forgotten this, I'll be honest. The funny thing is, I've never owned an LG phone, I don't think. So I have very, not a proper LG branded phone. I owned one of the Nexuses. So we'll get to that. But yeah, so they introduced the first proper touchscreen. A year later, 2007, the LG Beauty, also a touchscreen, was the first smartphone to have slow motion video.
Dang. Okay.
So it could record, I think it was 320p video at 120 frames per second.
That's actually pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks like a digital camera, doesn't it? That's like a digital camera.
You sort of look at these phones and they're very funny looking devices from a modern eye. I remember
lusting after the Prada, man. That design I really liked. That kind
the Prada
of,
was
you know,
spicy, yeah.
Black and silver cube, a cuboid. It was nice.
I have no memory of that phone. The Prada and the Beauty I'm looking at, don't register for me at all. I have no idea. I mean, I didn't really follow tech at that age, but still, yeah, there's absolutely no sense memory. I'm quite surprised there was slow-mo video in 2007. I think if you put me on the spot and told me to guess, I would have said like 2012.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Or something like that was when that first got introduced. That blew my mind a bit. The next big thing was then a few years later, but 2012, the Nexus 4, which LG built for Google, so it wasn't branded as an LG phone, but still, LG Nexus 4 was the first Android phone with Qi wireless charging. Again, way back in 2012, I couldn't quite believe we'd had wireless charging for that long, but apparently we did. Not the first phone with Qi wireless. There was a Lumia that beat them to it by a few months, but that was one of the Windows phone Lumias. So, you know, they had their own problems. Bless them.
Yeah, I think I used that Nexus. That's pretty good. It wasn't bad.
I didn't have the 4, but I had the Nexus 5, which was also an LG phone.
I mean, the 5, is that the one with the white back?
Yes. Yeah, I think
black front, white back. That, I love that.
I didn't have the white one, but I think they had a white version. But the Nexus 5 was a beautiful phone. That was a great Nexus.
Such a solid phone.
Absolutely fantastic. 2013. This is a phone I really did not know existed. Shows my like how much I was paying attention back in 2013. They introduced the first flexible phone, the LG G Flex.
The G Flex, yeah. It also had a healing plastic back.
Yeah, self-healing back. So
which was rubbish, by the way.
This is the banana phone, isn't it? The bendy weird one.
Yeah. So it just flexes a little bit. It's not a foldable or anything like that. It just had a flexible POLED panel. So it could just bend slightly.
But I remember, I think it was EE took me into like a room above one of their stores on Oxford Street to show it off. And they were like pressing it down on the table and being like, look, like, okay, cool. And it was massive for the time.
You can flatten it.
Yeah, great.
Yeah.
Just like a regular phone now, wow. Yeah. And I think it was like 6 inches, but because it was 16 by 9, it was a big flipping phone, especially for that time.
Yeah. I didn't note this down on my list, so I can't remember which one it was, but at some point in this, they did the first 21 by 9 display phone as well.
Nice.
They had an even more extreme asset ratio. I think maybe it might have been before. I think that might have been the chocolate that I was thinking of, the LG chocolate, but I think it was before they made the jump to Android. Might be mixing up my timeline now. But it had like a 24 by 9. It was like super thin. It was really weird.
There was that age of really weird form factors getting thrown around. 2016 was a big year for LG. Between the V20 and the G5, they had the first quad DAC in a phone. So that was when they started making their big audio file push. That was in the V20. Mm. The G5 was both the first modular phone and the first phone to feature an ultra-wide camera, which I think has to be the biggest innovation that LG threw in that really stuck. We were talking just now about ultra-wide cameras being thrown in when maybe they're not needed, but like every phone has an ultra-wide camera now. You have to go really, really cheap to not get an ultra-wide. But it was only 5 years ago that LG was the first to put that on a device.
The modules were ambitious. Like they had a B&O Play partnership, so you got like a speaker dock. There was you could pull out the battery, which is a bit weird. Like the way the battery pulled out, it was technically a module. What else did they have? They had a VR headset, if memory serves, which they classed as a module, but wasn't really a module because you just plugged it into the USB-C. What else did they have? A camera grip, maybe?
I'm not sure.
Like the Lumia 1020. It was a weird assortment.
But I have more awareness of the Motorola modular phone that was a couple years later.
Well, the Ara.
The Moto Mod.
Oh, the Moto Mods. Yeah, sure.
I mean, there's a fair point in the comments here from, I'm not sure that's IAR 1990. One of LG's biggest weaknesses was not actively promoting some of their excellent features, like the quad DAC, excellent manual controls on their cameras and so on. And that's it, isn't it? Because so many people, you know, they hit these amazing milestones and so many people don't even realize that LG was the first to do them or that they're there or what they mean. You know, and part of it, I think, was a problem of where they put their focus. The quad DAC is a really funny one because it marked the point where for a few years, the biggest thing that differentiated LG phones was they were the best phones for audio files. And wow, what a niche to go after. You know, fair play. It's good that it's there and that for people who really love that and want the best audio on their phone. But the prevalence of £20 headphones and people using in-the-box free headphones tells us that most people don't care. They can't tell the difference. They don't care. They're not using good enough headphones to notice the difference. They're maybe not getting good enough audio off their phone anyway because they're just streaming it or they have low-res MP3s. But, you know, as of a few years ago, like, it was a weird market to push for. And then the funny thing is they have such camera chops and, like we said, the first ultra-wide and everything, that they never really managed to communicate that well enough to people. And they never managed to really cement themselves in everyone's eyes as the best cameras around or in that conversation. I think part of the problem they had there was maybe they were nailing the hardware, but they just lost step on that like computational photography side of things. And it was sort of the Pixel phones coming in and changing the game for what mattered in a phone camera that took LG a bit by surprise. where they were figuring out all these great bits of hardware to put on the back of a phone. And then Google came along and said, oh no, we can throw in one kind of average phone sensor.
But do this for them.
We've just got enough lines of code going on here that it beats like all the hardware you've thrown in. And LG just never had the answer to that. And they never adapted quick enough to keep up with it.
In terms of that adaptation as well, like Samsung TouchWiz was generally a bad user experience on the older Samsung phones. Obviously, they're at one point their biggest local rival in Korea. But TouchWiz got better. I mean, even before One UI, it was so much better by the end before it switched to One UI than it was at the start. Whereas I feel like, what do they call it? It was LG UX eventually, I think. But before that, it was like Optimus UI or something.
Yeah.
To go with their name.
Yeah.
And that, I mean, it was ugly and it just wasn't intuitive. It was different. It was bad in a different way to like the way the Chinese manufacturers software felt. But it still wasn't good. It was just bad
in a different way. That's what you like to hear, isn't it?
yeah. And you know, you could see they were trying to work on it. It felt similar to if you use Zen UI on Asus phones for a long time. But even Asus have been fixing their experience, even though they've been far less, you know, active in the phone space. And I think that was another thing that just undermined any of the hardware work they were putting in because it was horrible. It just didn't feel nice to use.
Yeah. Absolutely. They never nailed the software side. Never interesting on the software side either. And then the space where they started to play around with that actually is then funny enough as we got into the last year or two when they started playing around with form factors again.
I freaking love
so
this.
Then we saw them having to like do their own software to make all their weird form factors work because we got the dual screen, which started I think the V50 was the first one to have a dual screen accessory, but it didn't have it worldwide. Like in the US it just launched as a regular phone, but other markets got it with the dual screen. But then we saw it in the GAX and a few others, so suddenly they had to come up with their own software to handle having two screen devices or like optionally two screen devices. And some apps being able to, you know, multi-screen and others being split down the middle. Then obviously we saw the LG Wing, which was the exact same thing, but from this weird swivelly T-shaped form factor. So they like created this problem for themselves all over again with a totally radical form factor that obviously no one at Google has coded for in Android. and then we would have seen that once more with the Rollable this year if it had materialized.
I think with the I remember discussing LG Wing on the show last year, and I was really happy that there were more companies, that the LG was one of the companies trying to push with kind of a different form factor and to try something different to the traditional foldables. And I think we might have questioned then whether it was like them having this like last hurrah of trying something completely different before.
Looks it, like.
It was. Or whether it was part of something. And we've got our answer now.
It always looked like a bit of a Hail Mary, didn't it? Yeah. Like they were just hoping it would take off and be a massive hit, and it was like it wasn't. So
No,
I think in decades to come, when they'll go back at like these craziest phones to ever come out, the LG will at least always have a place there, and they'll always be fondly remembered, like for some of their features.
That'll be a recurring mention for sure. I'm still actually sad I never used the Wing. I'd still like to track one down and get the chance to play around with an LG Wing. That looked really cool.
I think I talked about it when the Wing was first announced, but like I made a phone concept with my dad like years, 10 years prior to the Wing existing, that had a similar kind of revolving screen setup. And so this was the closest thing to like realizing that concept. And so I would have loved to have used it. But you know, in this episode where we're talking about Nokia as well, so much like it's funny that the two brands have kind of both coalesced in this episode because there was that, you know, before they really got into Windows Phone and then Android, you know, Nokia had its crazy phase, and I have fond memories of just going to the phone shops and looking at all the ridiculous form factors they were playing with that actually made it to market. Like it felt like you're in their concept store. It was crazy. And I loved them for that. And LG was kind of going in that direction. If they had the funds and the resources to do it, I would love to have seen what came after the Rollable.
The difference was Nokia was playing around with that stuff when it was at the height of its powers. You know, Nokia was the biggest phone company in the world. So they could churn out tens of millions of 3310s or whatever. And that gave them money to make the N-gauge.
Yes.
And to make the weird one that was like looked like a a lipstick tube and folded around itself and all this kind of stuff.
A seashell.
And what's interesting then is you look, they both had weird phases around the same time. And Nokia has survived until now. Obviously, it went away and has come back because, you know, being rebought as a brand, it's a different situation. But they survived by becoming the most boring phone company in the market. And I don't mean that to be too disparaging because it's clearly working for them. They are making boring, reliable, cheap phones. And that's what a lot of people want. And that works for them. And LG, maybe there was a route to survival that involved LG becoming like Nokia and just making boring, reliable phones. But that doesn't really fit the brand they want to project because they've got the rest of their tech business. And the funny thing is, this announcement came and then like 2 days after they announced they're closing it, they had their last quarter financials come out and they were astonishing, like absolutely phenomenal. They were making money hand over fist in every other bit of the business, you know, doing really fantastic. It is just phones that was this millstone around their neck. And so I can see why they felt the need to cut it loose. There's two more things I want to quickly talk about because we're already running late. One is the update promise. We spoke briefly about updates earlier, but LG made the quite surprising announcement just today or yesterday that they are still promising up to 3 years of updates for the recent phones if you still buy them. And they claim they will still deliver one of the better phone update promises on the market, even though they no longer make phones. I think we're all a touch skeptical that they're going to follow through on this.
They said like premium. I don't think they said flagship, but I think they said premium, which is like ambiguous enough. Like, yeah. Does the velvet class as premium? Or like, where's the line?
If that doesn't, then what does? I mean, recent.
Or like, does the G8X, because it's not the V50, and that was like the more premium phone, or, you know. So, yeah, to know where that line falls. But OS updates, I wasn't expecting that. I was expecting security updates, fine.
Totally, yeah.
So that's pretty good. It's commendable if they follow through on that.
I wonder how much it is, and this is in itself commendable, but how much it is a question of trying to find a way for people to keep their jobs and being like, you know, they've got an Android software team, and it's like, well, we can keep these people employed doing updates for 2 years. And if, you know, maybe that's my like rose tinted glasses or whatever. I like to think some of that might've been the thought process. I don't know.
I mean, I had a similar thought, is that they don't have to develop any new phones or any new software. So they can just focus on the things that they've got now and with a smaller team.
It's probably grand scheme, relatively cheap to keep a small team of software people on to maintain support. And it helps. I guess the whole pitch of it is it will help them sell through the last remaining bits of stock, because I'm sure they've still got a load in warehouses they need to ship to retailers, and they want to be able to say to retailers, these will still sell, you know, like
all those wings.
So I guess having a good software promise
helped. Yeah, quite. I'll take a wing.
But the final thing I want to talk about is something that actually again got raised in the comments just now by IAR 1980, but that is like, what happens for the market from here? Who stands to gain? And the quick, easy answer is no one. The LG only had 2% market share. It doesn't matter. but one of the interesting things that came out, well, this was for me at least, I hadn't quite clocked. LG may only have 2% market share worldwide, but they were the third biggest phone seller in the US.
That blows my mind.
It was Apple, Samsung, and LG. So it's sort of like, actually, suddenly this is a massive shakeup for the US market. And here in Europe, we're like, oh, well, no one bought LG phones anyway. It doesn't matter. But actually, for the US, it's huge. They were still a reasonably decent player in Latin America as well. And obviously, in their native Korea, they weren't actually huge in Korea. I think there's a sense people maybe think, oh, Samsung and LG are the top dogs in Korea. And they were further down the ranking than that. But still, they had a place in that market. I think they basically made their figures on mid-range stuff and budget stuff that we didn't even see in Europe from them. They didn't even push those phones out over here.
The Q and the K series and stuff that we heard about but never got hands on.
Exactly. So, the obvious brands you look at there, especially with the Latin America, you'd say Motorola sweeps in and takes a lot of that space. Could be good for Nokia as well. We're already speaking about in that same space.
Who's going to make the audiophile's phone? I guess Sony's kind of pushed the audio on its phones for a while. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's actually exactly what this comment said, is that they hope Sony can take advantage from pushing the 3.5mm headphone jack in their phones and their camera system, and that kind of audiophile nerd into certain kind of camera nerd where there's still a pedigree to those companies. Like
the ROG phone Sony also has a DAC as well, so top tip.
Yeah, I mean, if that's gaming phones are often pushing audio, so to some extent you may find a lot of audio nerds really begrudgingly carrying around giant like RGB lit gaming handsets just because it's the only phone that gives them good wide
sounds
audio.
So good.
I mean, the depressing obvious news is it's probably really good news for Samsung in the US because also they do still dominate across the price range, and it will just accelerate that Samsung-Apple duopoly in the States. But God, I really hope some brand can get in there and make headway, but I don't know who, because I can't see a Chinese brand becoming big in the US market anytime soon.
I guess similar to Sony, actually, I'm surprised that they were never really able to leverage the ecosystem angle as well as they could have done. Samsung's managed to do it. Apple's done it. But LG's never really done it.
Well, it's like we were saying, the rest of the business is doing great. Their TVs, all their computer stuff, like they're fantastic. And
LG Gram, so
yeah,
good.
The laptops have been so good.
Yeah,
beautiful.
And they just never made that push of saying, well, you're buying an LG TV. Don't you want to think about an LG phone to go with it? And they just never made people think of it that way. I don't know how they were structured. I know historically Sony had this funny thing where all their internal divisions were in internal competition rather than cooperation.
Siloed, weirdly. Yeah. It was stupid.
I don't know if LG took the same approach or not. That would kind of, to some extent, explain it. Suggestion from the comments, the Google's link up with T-Mobile and the US would see Pixel devices move up into third place, followed by OnePlus. I've got to admit, I don't know the US market as well as I'd like to. I'd be a bit surprised to see Pixel take spot number three. I mean, they sell in massive numbers.
But there's like no Chinese players over there. Like you could kind of count Motorola as a Chinese player, I guess, now. But
I think if any brand was about to become number three, my guess would be Motorola.
Yeah, maybe.
Just from sheer volume of phones they put out.
Shotgun effect.
OnePlus and Pixel are just on a smaller scale. They're loved and they get a lot of coverage, but I think the number of units shifted is relatively light. Again, commenter made the point that Sony doesn't have carrier agreements, so they're not in a position in the US to really leverage it.
One thing LG says it is going to continue to do beyond software updates is also still invest in telecoms as a like in infrastructure. So like briefly joked about 6G earlier, but they actively in their release said we're going to be doing 6G stuff. So whatever that manifests as, it's probably not going to be stuff that consumers will directly be able to buy and use unless they do like a MiFi or something. But
there's also rumors that they're working with Apple on their foldable display as well for when the iPhone.
Interesting.
Because they're a huge display company and that is TVs, but it also is they make the displays for a lot of other phone companies. The rumor is they're doing Apple's foldable. There's plenty of phones from other brands that feature LG display tech in them and stuff like that. So LG will be absolutely fine. They're doing grand. But we just won't see them making LG branded phones, which is a shame. And we will never see the Rollable, which is a real shame. Which is, and in that very small niche, great news for Oppo. Any other company with a definite Rollable device on the way. X2021
has got a clear path ahead now.
Yeah, exactly. Great news for Oppo. They will be laughing. That is all, I think. This has been an extra long episode of Fast Charge this week. So we need to shoot off. Thank you to everyone who has been watching and listening. We will, of course, be back next week. The Xperia launch event is happening between now and then, so we will definitely be talking about the new Sony phones next week, and we'll see what else comes along. Until then, bye, everyone.
Bye, guys.
Bye.